Let's look at chi-square tests for one-way tables. In a one-way table, observations are classified according to a single categorical variable. For example, in a study of blood types, a sample of 100 individuals might reveal the following table. Here we have 43 individuals with blood type O, and so on. Blood type is a categorical variable. Each individual falls into one and only one of these four categories. And we might be interested in testing a hypothesis about the distribution of blood types. So, for example, somebody might contend that these four blood types are equally likely, and we might want to see if this sample gives strong evidence against that claim. The example we're going to work through is a famous genetics experiment in 1905 that investigated inheritance in sweet peas. In this experiment, one pure line of peas that had purple flowers and long pollen grains was crossed with another pure line that had red flowers and round pollen grains. This first generation was then self-crossed. Here are the results for the resulting 381 plants. There are four possible phenotypes. The phenotype is simply the observed characteristics of the plant. And we had 281 plants that had purple flowers and long pollen grains, 21 that had purple flowers and round pollen grains, 21 that had red flowers and long pollen grains, and 55 that had red flowers and round pollen grains. Genetics theory tells us that if these two genes are inherited independently, a 9:3 to 3:1 ratio would be expected. And if you want more information on that, do an internet search of 9:3 to 3:1, and a lot of information will come up. We're going to test the null hypothesis that the true ratio of those four phenotypes is 9:3 to 3:1. Or in other words, those two genes are being inherited independently. The alternative hypothesis is going to be that that is simply not the case. The true ratio is not this, and those genes are not being inherited independently. We could write this null hypothesis out a little bit differently, in terms of probabilities of the different categories. This 9 represents purple flowers and long pollen grains, and so we could write out that the null hypothesis is that the probability of getting a plant with purple flowers and long pollen grains is 9 out of 16, 9 out of the 16 total, and so on for the other four categories. And we are asking ourselves this question: are the counts observed in the sample significantly different from those expected under the null hypothesis? Here again are our probabilities under the null hypothesis, and we're going to use these to get our expected counts, what we would expect to see in each of those categories on average if the null hypothesis were true. And we're going to get that by multiplying these hypothesized probabilities by our total sample size. We had 381 plants, so I'm multiplying that by my hypothesized probability here, and I get 214.3. So if the null hypothesis were true, I would expect to get, on average, 214.3 plants with purple flowers and long pollen grains. And I'm simply going to do this for the rest of them. Multiply by the total sample size. Here I get 71.4. The same thing in this third category, of course. And for the last one, we're going to get 23.8. So these are our expected counts under the null hypothesis. Now I've rounded it off to one decimal place there, but in these chi-square tests you should typically carry many decimal places throughout the calculations. Here again are the observed counts from the sample and the expected counts under the null hypothesis. Over here in this category we actually saw 284 plants with purple flowers and long pollen grains, but if the null hypothesis were true, we would expect to see on average only 214.3. And over here for red flowers and round pollen grains, we saw 55, but we would expect to see under the null hypothesis only 23.8. The difference between the observed counts and the expected counts seem quite large to my eye, but we're going to go ahead and carry out a formal test of the hypothesis. The test statistic is going to be a chi-square test statistic, where for each cell, we take what we saw in the sample, we subtract what we would expect to get in that cell on average if the null hypothesis were true, square it, divide it by the expected count, and then add it up over all cells. If the null hypothesis is true, this test statistic is going to have approximately a chi-square distribution. Under certain conditions, and loosely speaking, those conditions are that we have a large enough sample size. For one-way tables, the degrees of freedom are the number of cells minus 1, or in other words, the number of categories we have minus 1. If we take another look at this test statistic, note that if the observed counts are close to the expected counts, then the test statistic is going to be small. And if the observed counts are very different from the expected counts, well, then the test statistic is going to be large. And so large values of the test statistic give us evidence against the null hypothesis. For a given degrees of freedom, the greater the value of the test statistic, the greater the evidence against the null hypothesis. And so when we go to get our p-value, we are simply going to take the observed value of our test statistic. So I'm going to call this the observed value of the test statistic, and the p-value is going to be the probability under the null hypothesis of getting that value or something even larger. Or in other words, the area to the right of our test statistic under a chi-square distribution with the appropriate degrees of freedom. Here again is our table of observed and expected counts. And let's take a look at this purple and long category again. We had 284 actually observed in the sample, and under the null hypothesis, we'd expect to see 214.3 on average. To construct our chi-square test statistic, for each cell we take the observed count, subtract the expected count, square that, and then divide by the expected. So this cell has this contribution to the chi-square test statistic. And we do that for all four of the cells, and then we simply add it up. Overall, we get a chi-square test statistic value of 134.7. Now we need to see how large of a chi-square test statistic that is. We want to get the appropriate p-value. To do so, we need the degrees of freedom. So our degrees of freedom in these one-way tables are simply the number of cells minus 1. Here we had 1, 2, 3, 4 categories, 4 cells. We had these 4 terms that we were adding up, so the degrees of freedom are simply 4 minus 1, which is 3. Here I've plotted out the chi-square distribution with 3 degrees of freedom and the observed value of our test statistic. The p-value is the probability of getting this value or something even farther out to the right if the null hypothesis is actually true. So the p-value is simply the area to the right of our test statistic. As we can probably see just looking at this distribution, the p-value is tiny here. The p-value is very, very small and very, very close to zero. Because the p-value is very, very small and very close to zero, there is very, very strong evidence against the null hypothesis. In this case, that means there is extremely strong evidence that these phenotypes do not occur in a 9 to 3 to 3 to 1 ratio. And in fact, this study was important in the discovery of genetic linkage, where genes close to each other on the same chromosome are more likely to be inherited together. So sometimes the statistical methods discussed in an introductory statistics course can help with some very important discoveries.